Hi everyone, thanks for attending the session. So today I'll be presenting our paper, Concurrent Binary Trees for Large-Scale Game Components. So our goal with this paper was to create a unified technique to render large-scale environments to allow players to explore them in an interactive way and making the development process easier for game developers. So before jumping into the presentation, I'd like to show you a video. So it's a capture of an application that shows and demonstrates the technique, and it's running on a GPU that is equivalent to a PS5, and it's running at about 250 FPS. All right. And obviously there's no sound. Yeah. So I hope you enjoyed that. So I feel sometimes it's hard to have a grasp on how really these assets are large. And so we're going to do something to put this into perspective. So let's take back the initial shot that I showed you. And so here the camera is above the water surface. And what we're going to do is going to freeze the mesh update. We're going to fly out, go back to in space, in our space, and we're going to look at our mesh from different perspective. And now we're going to zoom back on that mesh. And the way we do it is by changing the FOV of the camera so it matches the red square. So OK, we'll do it again. Let's zoom again. We'll zoom again, and again, and again, and again, and one more time. OK, so I think this helps to put in perspective how many subdivision level details we need to be able to achieve what we're trying to achieve. And let's put this aside. And let's have a look at what the game industry has been doing for the last years. So the term large-scale game components is mostly used in games to refer to terrain and water surfaces. From the two examples that you've seen on screen, they represent the majority of pixels that are in the frame. They happen to be expensive to render, and they remain quite unsolved because every year there is publications and presentations about how to handle them in every game and graphics conference. So to simplify, we can divide this large-scale game component problem into two sub-problems. So the first one is generating data, so deformation and material properties, so textures, normals, etc. So this can be done procedurally through a simulation process or with a ton of pre-baked data and streaming mechanic. So there's plenty of high-quality presentation about this, but this is not what our paper is about. This presentation is about rendering that surface to the screen, and this includes many sub-problems, but the main one usually is handling the geometry through a level of detail mechanic. So we can classify the level of detail algorithms into two categories, so the first one being decimation algorithms, and the most famous one at the moment is Nanite. So it's a very powerful technique, but it does not allow to scale for terrains that are bigger than a couple of kilometers. And the reason for that is that you need to be able to load, store the full geometry, and that's unfit for planet-sized assets, even with very advanced compression algorithms. So to precise this thought, what we did is we did an estimation of what would be just the full res mesh of a planet. So we found out it to be a couple exabytes, one exabyte being 1 milliterabyte. We did not manage to find an SSD that big. And that's why game engines like Unreal usually have another system, something ad hoc, to handle the large scale part of the water surfaces of the terrains. And in this case, for the water, they have what they call a mesh actor for distant surfaces. And so one, it's multiple systems to handle, which is not nice. And it's also a delicate task to decide where you switch from one presentation to the other, when, especially when your camera goes into high elevations. So the second family of tessellation, or the second family of level detail algorithms, are tessellation-based algorithms. So there is a couple solutions that are used or being used in productions, were used in productions. So I'm not going to go into details, but while they are good, and they're good for a couple dozens of kilometers terrains, you cannot go beyond that, either because of their memory footprint or because of the maximum subdivision level. All right. So in order to better illustrate the different scalability between what we propose and what was existing before, so I'm going to show you a video, and this video is going to show three tessellation techniques. And each technique is going to, so tessellation headers on the left, one of the previous techniques in the middle, and our technique on the right, and each technique is going to freeze when the maximum subdivision level is going to be reached. Okay, so I hope this appreciates to understand how much deeper we can go using the technique in terms of subdivisions and how it unlocks new possibilities. So as you probably noticed, the tessellation scheme of the middle and the 1 hour on the right, it was the same. It's because we extended the technique, which is the one highlighted in green. And that technique uses concurrent binary trees and on top of the longest edge bisection scheme. So just to do a refresher, what is the longest edge bisection scheme? So it's a scheme where you have bisectors and their triangles. They're called bisectors because we can bisect them. As you can see, this will create a T-junction, which is not something we want. So we're going to do and propagate that bisection until no T-junctions are left. To do so, we need to have some form of neighboring and geometry information. And when the bisection has been applied, we get a new consistent triangulation, and we're going to iterate from that to either merge or subdivide again. So to represent the triangulation, the previous method that I showed you before, Dupuis 2020, would use what is called a concurrent binary tree. So it's a binary tree which is shown at the bottom of the slide that we encode implicitly the geometry relatively to a quad. So the CBT is composed of a bit field and a tree. The bits at the bottom that are in green and orange, one set to 1 and 0, would allow to decode the vertex position and the neighbors. And the binary tree, which stores some reduction of the bit field, would allow to know the number of triangles and iterate over them. So for instance, here the root node will tell us there are 13 triangles in this representation. And also we need to redo a sum reduction every time we modify this tree. So it's a problem of this construction is that the maximum number of subdivisions is linked to the maximum depth of the tree, and mean that if we need a deeper subdivision, we need a wider tree, or at least a wider bit field and a deeper tree. So, for instance, if we subdivide a bit more the mesh that we've shown before, so here there's the corresponding bit field. So in green, we have the bits that are used, and in red, we have the ones that are not used. So we can notice two things from here. So the first one is that the data in the bit field is very sparse. So in this case, 80% of the bit field is wasted. And every time we add a potential subdivision, it's going to double. So it's going to become quite rapidly unmanageable in terms of memory size and reduction time. So this is an image from the demo that was shipped with the previous version of the technique. So this technique renders an 8x8 kilometer terrain with a high level of detail. So in practice, the active primitive count of this method is never more than 54K primitives, even for a depth of 25, and less than 0.2% of the allocated memory space is actually used. And the footprint is 256 megabytes. And if we compare that to our technique, so we can render a terrain that is significantly larger. So the Earth would be equivalent to a square of 22,500 by 22,500 kilometer terrain. And the memory footprint of our CBT is about 7 megabytes. And if you compare the results side by side, there's quite a gap between the two techniques. So to summarize, here are the limitations of the previous approach. So it's limited to a quad, and applying this technique to an arbitrary mesh would be an NP-hard problem. It has the advantage of having an implicit representation of the geometry, but that comes at the cost of coupling the CBT def and the maximal subdivision that we can have. The main cost is high as soon as we get into deep CBTs, and it makes the performance limited due to the sum reduction that we can operate. So now we're going to compare that to our technique. So obviously we can render the same terrain, but much bigger as we discussed before. We can render planets, which was not possible the previous method. The planet in the demo is rendered using an icosahedron, which is a specific mesh, but actually we can render any arbitrary mesh using our technique, which make it significantly more useful for non-trivial cases. So, as I mentioned, we drop the implicit representation and we store the bisector explicitly with their neighbors. By doing that by breaking that implicit constraint, we're able to decouple the CBT size and the subdivision def. We can use the CBT as a lightweight memory manager, and we can make the process highly parallel. Okay, so now we're gonna look at how we made the technique compatible with arbitrary meshes. So we start from an arbitrary mesh, and by that we mean a mesh with an arbitrary number of primitives and an arbitrary polygon count for each primitive. And this is our base geometry in this case. So we're gonna convert it to a half-edge structure. And this half-edge structure is gonna have a couple of operators. These operators, twin, previous, and next, will allow us to build the neighborhood that we need for the lab structure. And then from there, we're gonna create a new point per face. And each half edge of the half edge structure is going to produce one root bisectors. These bisectors can only be refined. In our case, we represent the geometry using what is called the heap ID. So it's something stored into a uint and encodes the geometry. But in our case, we use specifically uint64 for getting deeper depths. And it allows to encode the relative subdivision of the triangle to the root bisector. So we assign a heap ID using the formula that is here on screen. And we can start eventually subdividing our geometry, ensuring there are no G-junctions every time. And this will produce this geometry that we'll use to explain the following steps of the algorithm. So obviously, the mesh that we're showing is simple, but the technique, again, works for any mesh. So here's an arbitrary mesh. We can see that it has both quads and triangles as base primitives. And the technique runs fine with our algorithm. Okay, so now that we explained how we were able to feed any input mesh to our technique, the next step is about the explicit representation and the CBT as memory manager. So we're going to start from memory pool, which is just basically an area of data. These areas of data in green are allocated, and in green are unused. In our paper, the memory pool will store the heap ID and the neighbors, as mentioned before. And for the table that we see here, that's a representation of the mesh that is on the top left of the slide. So we're going to go back to the simplified memory pool just for visual clarity. The CBT is a memory manager, so it will track the slots that are free, associating one bit of the CBT with each slot of the memory pool. As mentioned before, this will break the implicit representation between the CBT and the lab scheme. Given that it is just a memory manager, we need to define a set of operators to be able to use it as a parallel memory manager. So the first one is how much memory is used and how much is available. So that's easy. That's just the root node of the tree. Then the next operation is the atomic allocation. So we need to find the eth bit that is set to 0, set it atomically to 1, and operate a sum reduction. So in this case, we're going to allocate the bit number 17. And we are going to update the tree accordingly. The same way, we need an operation to free atomically a given bit. So we need two operators for that, setting a bit atomically to 0 and doing a sum reduction on the tree. In this case, we're going to free the bit number 1. OK. And the next question is, what size should be our CBT? So from what we've seen before, the amount of active primitives is actually very small compared to the maximum bisectors that we could have. So on our demo, we noticed that we could never go back more than 100K primitives, even at a depth of 63. Which is the maximal depth that I showed you earlier. So our CBT needs to be able to manage an element count that is around that magnitude in an efficient way. So in practice, our implementation, GPU implementation, supports four sizes, which are these. And this is the memory footprint for every one of the sizes, which allow the users to scale either up or down, depending on the density of the mesh that they have and the power of their GPU. OK, so that covers the explicit representation and the CBT as a memory manager. So now we're able to take any mesh, feed it to our system, and we have something that allows us to allocate and deallocate bisectors in a parallel way. And the next step is how do we make the process highly parallel. So I just want to warn you for the rest of the presentation, I'll be going a bit more into detail. So I'm going to give you an overview of the update GPU pipeline. It's OK if you don't follow everything. The source code is available, and the slides will be available as well. So to explain the process, we'll go through the mesh that I've shown before, and we'll show one split and one simplification. So the way the GPU pipeline works is we're going to have a consecutive number of indirect dispatches, and that's just for performance. One thread is usually going to run on one target bisectors, and the set of bisectors is going to change depending on the pass. So we start from the triangulation that we've probably shown. The first thing that we're going to do is going to classify the bisectors into one of three categories, so keep, unchanged, split, refined, or decimated, merged. That is going to be done based on multiple criteria, so triangle area on screen, intersection with one multiple frustums, the max depth, is it a root bisector, et cetera. And based on that, we're going to store that information for the next step. The next step, the first one that we do is the split. So we, in this case, only have one triangle to process, the one with the heap ID 46. So it needs to be split once, so we need to do one allocation. So we allocate the first bit, that would be the basic bit 16. As you can see, this creates a T-junction, so we're going to have to propagate that, so we move on to the next one. We're going to allocate two bits, and that's good. So no T-junction left, so we can move on to the next step. So the next step is modifying the heap IDs and the neighbors for the bisectors that we had, but also for the bisectors that were created. So the one located in slots 16, 17, and 18. But that's not good enough, because they were bisectors pointing to those initial bisectors. We're going to change those as well. And with that, we have a new consistent geometry. So that's it for the split. And now we're going to look at the merge, which is relatively a similar process, except there is no propagation to take account for. So in this case, we have four bisectors that requested the merge operation. It's important that the four of them requested, otherwise the merge operation would have been canceled. So same thing as for the split. So we modify the bisectors going to stay, so the first two. And we're going to nullify the ones that will become unused. Same as for the bisection. There were bisectors pointing to the bisectors, so we need to fix those bisectors' neighbors in a different pass. And with that, we're able to have, again, a new consistent geometry. So after all we did, and the split and decimations, we modified the bit field with our allocations, but the tree does not match anymore, so we need to be able to operate some reduction on it. So to be able to do all the operations efficiently on the CBT, we store it into group shared memory. However, the index of the group shared memory is limited to 32 kilobytes, so we need to compress the CBT to be able to handle a large memory pool. So the way we do it is we decompose the CBT into four parts. So the part that is in red, which is an atomic-friendly subtree, stored in UN32, and we do that to take advantage of atomic intrinsics. In green, we have a per-thread tree that we only modify one thread at a time. It's stored in the minimal power of two size to be able to hold the data, and also stored in group shared memory. Then we have a bunch of levels that we call virtual levels, so they're not stored explicitly and can be deduced from the last level, which is the raw bitfield buffer stored in UN64s. And that's to take advantage of a bunch of intrinsics, atomics, and bit count. So this will allow us to reduce quite significantly the memory footprint of our CBT. So we move from 7 megabytes to 3 kilobytes into shared memory. And we only access outside of shared memory once per thread. All right, so we operate a reduction. Our tree is good to go. But the next step is to modify the positions for the bisectors that have been created and modified. So in this case, this is the set, and we get the new positions that we need. But these positions are not ready to go yet. We need to apply some kind of deformation, so that is dependent on what the user is doing. So for the Earth, it was a bunch of FFTs, and for the Moon, it was the elevation data that is available online for the Moon, plus a bunch of noise functions to be able to get higher frequency details. OK. And for that, we're ready to rasterize everything. This covers a high-level overview of the improvements that we made. skip this. Okay, so the last thing I would like to talk about is the performance of the method. So this is a capture of this running on a GPU that is equivalent to the one of a PlayStation 5. And the part that we're interested in is the part that is in red there. So you can come back to this. This is a lot to parse. But the important bit is that we're able to stay at a reasonable cost, and that's around 0.2 milliseconds for the update process for a console, which is suitable for a game production. Okay, that covers it for me. I know I only gave an overview of the implementation details, but if you're interested, there is actually a more technical presentation, advances at SIGGRAPH. So feel free to join if you're interested to know about the technique. In the meantime, I'm going to launch a demo, and I'm going to be available for questions. Yeah, I'm ready to take questions if you have any.
How would this work with large-scale textures and game assets?
So the way it works. The question is, how would this work with large game textures as input? So the moon is pretty much that's what it is. So when you apply your deformation, so the last step of the pipeline, you read from your mega texture and you apply the deformation to each of your vertices that were produced by the. Is this good? Yes. Beth and.
Can I have our next speaker come to the.
Oh, sure. Yeah, just this and. Is there another question? No?
Okay.
All right, I'm just going to run this.
Okay.
And
if it doesn't, it's about the reason.